Good afternoon, everyone. It's a joy and privilege to welcome you all today for the American Scientific Affiliation Winter Symposium. We are so delighted to have each and every one of you here with a packed Zoom house from 41 countries around the globe. Also, we want to warmly greet our international partner organizations, as well as our sponsors, Christianity Today and Christian Book. My name is Vicki Best. I serve as the Director of Operations and Development for the ASA, and I am joining you from Topsfield, Massachusetts, which is on the North Shore of Boston and the location of the ASA headquarters. As we have navigated the turmoil of the last year with the pandemic, racial tensions, and political polarization, Christians are looking for reliable information from fellow believers who understand science and are grounded in scripture. In the midst of much challenge and transformation taking place in our lives, the American Scientific Affiliation is delighted to bring you this timely event with the nation's biomedical research leader, Dr. Francis Collins, on scientific and spiritual lessons in the time of COVID. We are proud to call Francis an ASA member and an elected fellow, as well as a wonderful ambassador and friend of our organization. For those new to the American Scientific Affiliation, we are an international network of Christians in the natural and social sciences. Our mission is to encourage the Christian church and scientific community to engage in perspectives about science and faith while providing a community of fellowship for Christians in the sciences. We have about 4,000 members worldwide, and you can learn more about the ASA and membership at asa3.org. As we spend the next 60 minutes together, I know you are in for a meaningful time as Francis brings his years of thoughtful reflection and research, as well as personal stories of vocation and calling as a Christian in the sciences. Our sincere hope is that God will richly bless you along the way. Now, there are inevitably people who wanted to be here but could not, so fear not. This presentation is being recorded, and we will be offering the link to the video recording next week. Let me give you an overview of how our symposium will run and what you can look forward to today. This will be a 3-hour event. The first hour block is this webinar with Francis's talk, including a Q&A time and a special treat at the conclusion. So be sure to stay with us until the end. Block number 2 will be a Zoom meeting that you will need to join, where we will break out into regional discussion groups, each with a facilitator. And finally, in hour 3, and after a 15-minute break, we will have 45 minutes of social and fellowship time. And we certainly hope that you plan to spend the whole 3 hours with us. Now, a couple of Zoom housekeeping reminders. First of all, we want you all to be social and friendly. It looks like you are already doing so. So use the chat function to greet each other. Say hello to old friends, meet new ones in the chat box, and feel free to post on social media outlets as well. And secondly, questions can be submitted through the Q&A box. We won't be able to get to every question, but we will do our best to address as many as possible. So again, be social in the chat box, submit questions through the Q&A box. And finally, I want to recognize the many people who made this event possible today. In addition to our sponsors, Christianity Today and Christian Book, our loyal and dedicated team who have been working tirelessly behind the scenes, Becky, Dana, Mark, and Lynn, thank you all, as well as our amazing planning team of ASA chapter leaders from around the US and Canada who have provided valuable input as well. Now I'd like to turn it over to my colleague, John Wood, who is serving a dual leadership role as interim executive director and the president of our board of directors. John will introduce Francis and moderate the Q&A session. Welcome, John.
Thank you, Vicki, and welcome everyone. I'm watching that stream in chat of greetings and seeing friends old and new from right across the continent and around the world, and it's so fun to see that this morning. Francis, it is good to have you with us in this ASA Winter Symposium. So welcome this morning or this afternoon, wherever you are. For those who might not know, Francis is now serving in his third presidential administration in his role as the director of the National Institutes of Health in Washington, D.C. And Francis, this is a great encouragement to all of us who love the sciences and good governance as well. Many will know you best from your work with BioLogos that you founded together with your wife, Diane, with the goal of fostering a rich discussion about the harmony between science and biblical faith. Your success in this mission of BioLogos has been widely recognized. And last May, the Sir John Templeton Foundations honored you and that work with the Templeton Prize, celebrating scientific and spiritual curiosity. And I know I heard that your lecture, as many of us did, on harmony and the sciences and a touch of disharmony as well. Yet others will recall you best from hearing this story that I'm going to read from the pages of the Language of God. Just think with me for a moment. On a warm summer day, just 6 months into the new millennium, humankind crossed a bridge into a momentous new era. An announcement beamed around the world, highlighted in virtually all major newspapers, trumpeted that the first draft of the human genome, our own instruction book, had been assembled. That was a remarkable time. Now, let's fast forward, and I'll paraphrase. Just one short year ago, the narrative scene shifts. On a cold winter day, some two decades later, humankind crosses another bridge into a momentous new era. In a globalized world joined by air transportation and instant pervasive communications, another announcement was beamed around the world, highlighted in virtually all major newspapers, trumpeting the World Health Organization's announcement of the COVID-19 pandemic. The roaring 20s of the 21st century will reverberate in history as the time of the modern version of the Great Plague. Now today, a short year later, we stand at a turning point. Everyone is looking for the impact of these new vaccines. We long for the inflection of this curve, the infection curve, signaling to us that the worst is past, that there is hope of a new dawn at hand. And at this moment, it is fitting to hear from you. On behalf of hundreds of thousands of skilled and gifted individuals that are leading the charge toward relief and flourishing once again, the new vaccines are flowing into arms around the world. So today we pause to reflect together with you on the scientific and spiritual lessons to be learned from this remarkable time of COVID. Francis, our minds are open, and we are eager to know what is on your mind today.
Well, thank you, John, for a wonderful, kind introduction and very much setting the stage for the seriousness of the conversation we need to have today about what we, as followers of Jesus, are called to do in the era of COVID with so many stresses and distresses around us. And I will try to see if I can at least get that conversation going, but I'll look forward to the chance for us all to discuss this together in the Q&A and the other parts of this three-hour session that ASA has carefully put together. I'm going to share my screen because I have some visuals that I want to try to include in this 30-minute presentation. And there's always this moment where you hope that your visuals are in fact appearing, and unless somebody tells me otherwise, I'm going to assume that you can now see these. So welcome, everyone. It's astounding, as I was watching the counter there of participants, seeing it rise, and now 1.1K, in other words, 1,100 people have logged on, I gather from what Vicky told me, from 41 countries. So this is truly not just the American scientific affiliation. This seems to be the world scientific affiliation. And as a member of ASA now for many decades, I want to give a big shout out to the way in which this organization has provided the kind of meeting place that those of us who are both scientists and serious Christians long for, because we are considered to be unicorns in a certain way. And we all know that's not the case. There are many thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of us, but to have an opportunity to have an organization like ASA has been a great gift to me over these decades. And I want to say thank you to the leadership and for your creativity in putting together this winter gathering, even though we have to do it virtually. I want to talk about both the scientific and the spiritual perspective that we might bring to COVID-19. And part of this will also be a way of introducing this notion that science and spirit, considered by many in our societies to be in conflict, have never been that way for me since I became a Christian at age 27. And I'm very fond of this particular pair of images as a means of kind of bringing that point across. You see the rose window at York Minster Cathedral, and then you see the view down the long axis of DNA. Remarkable sort of visual similarity there, but also an opportunity to reflect for a moment about what it means to be a scientist who gets to discover things like this beautiful structure and learns about the complexity of our universe using the tools of science. And for a believer, that becomes not just an opportunity of academic interest or of curiosity, it also becomes an opportunity of worship as you are uncovering things that God knew all along, and we are being given the privilege of being able to understand them through the tools of science. So when people say, well, if you're a scientist, you must not be very much of a believer, or you must have lost your sense of awe, I counter that just the opposite has been the case for me, that as a scientist who gets to do this kind of discovery work, every discovery adds to the awe that I have of the beauty and the elegance and the complexity of God's creation. Faith and science seems to me, and again, I'm going to speak very generally for the first couple of minutes here because we have a very broad audience. They are not in conflict. They are two different ways of knowing. It's often sort of described that science is a way of answering the how questions and faith is a way of answering the why questions. That's one way of putting it. And I think that's not a bad place to start. I actually like even better Francis Bacon's way of putting this into words, which is that we are able to read, thanks to God's grace, the books that God gave us, but it's two books and not one. The book of God's words, scripture, and the book of God's works, nature. And it would not be reasonable for those books to disagree with each other or to be in conflict. So if we have identified areas where we think that's the case, then there maybe is something wrong with our reading and our interpretation, and we should use that as an opportunity to learn more about really what are these books trying to tell us. And so this is, and I did speak about this in the Templeton lecture back in the fall, not an opportunity for conflict, but one for harmony, for complementarity. And for those of us who are able, as both scientists and Christians, to bring both of those worldviews to a particular experience, it seems to me greatly enriching. I am not an endorser, therefore, of the Stephen Jay Gould model of the non-overlapping magisteria. My magisteria overlap all the time. But again, one must keep in clear sense, what kind of question are you asking, and which toolkit should you be using to try to approach it? Let me very quickly tell you how I see everything I know as a scientist about the nature of the universe and everything I know as a believer who trusts in the words of Scripture, to put that all together into a very simple synthesis. Almighty God, who's not limited in space or time, created a universe 13.77 billion years ago with its parameters precisely tuned to allow the development of complexity and beauty over long periods of time. Science backs that up quite nicely. God's original plan included the mechanism of evolution to create the marvelous diversity of living things on our planet. Most especially, that creative plan included human beings, not at all a random outcome. And after God's plan for evolution in the fullness of time had prepared a sufficiently advanced brain, humanity was gifted with free will, consciousness, and importantly, a moral sense. And thus humans were granted special status made in God's image, not in physical image, but in spiritual image. We humans use that free will, however, to disobey God, leading to our realization of being in violation of the moral law. I'm talking about the fall, of course. Thus, we were estranged from God, our creator, who embodies all that is good, loving, and holy. But here's the solution. Through his life, death, and resurrection, Jesus Christ is the solution to that estrangement. So I believe in all of those things, including the literal resurrection of Jesus Christ, as something which, if one is willing to acknowledge God the Creator and Christ as God's Son, does not violate one's scientific views about the miraculous. If you want to learn more about ways in which scientists have wrestled with these issues, about how to put faith and science together, again, I would point you towards the BioLogos website. John very graciously mentioned this at the beginning. I had the pleasure and privilege of getting to know a number of other people who are thinking deeply about these issues after I wrote this book called The Language of God that he read from. And that led to the formation of this foundation. Shortly after its launch, I was required to step away from it because of being a federal employee reporting to the president, at that point, Obama. And so BioLogos has gone on its own way wonderfully well with leadership now, including Dr. Deb Haarsma, who's the president, and many others along the way, who have turned this into a wonderful meeting place for people to discuss these issues, with now some 2 million visitors every year. If you've not found biologos.org, please do so. I consider BioLogos and ASA to be wonderful partners, and am grateful to ASA for the way in which they have also encouraged people to look at this site as a place to encounter like-minded people who have deeply thoughtful approaches, always done in a civil, loving way. No mudslinging allowed. Well, let's now move to the crisis of the last 12 months. And it was interesting, John Wood was reading about this in the context of WHO declaring that this coronavirus outbreak is a public health emergency of international concern. And that actually happened exactly 1 year ago. That was January 30th, 2020. Here we are, exactly 12 months later. And what has happened? Here are some early headlines from early January of 2020 indicating that some rising concerns were happening about Wuhan, China. But even in those early points, it was not clear whether this was going to be a virus that threatened the world quite as much as we subsequently learned it had, because it wasn't immediately disclosed that this was capable of person-to-person transmission. As we all know, that became rapidly clear. And as the virus found its way across the world, terrible devastations have been happening for these last 12 months. It is a virus that's called a coronavirus because of its appearance. It has this circular spherical structure, but it has these spike proteins on the surface, which look like a crown of light, I suppose, if you want to be willing to call something as awful as this a circle of light. I just point out that spike protein because it's going to be relevant to some of the science I want to share with you. This is the way in which this virus finds its way into your cells. This spike protein binds to a particular target, a receptor called ACE2, and human cells have ACE2, particularly in the respiratory tract, but not only in the respiratory tract. And so the virus uses that as a means of entry. Particularly point you to this green squiggle at the top here in this 3D structure, which is the receptor binding domain. That's the part that most avidly attacks and attaches itself to ACE2 and grants entry. And once inside, the virus takes over the machinery of that cell to make oodles and boodles of copies of itself, ultimately lysing the cell and spreading itself around to the neighborhood. It's very good at this. Now, this is not the only coronavirus that has threatened humanity. SARS was a coronavirus. MERS in the Middle East was a coronavirus. Those were also pretty scary, but nothing like what SARS-CoV-2, which is now the name of this virus, has done for our world. If you're tracking what's happened in this pandemic, there are multiple places you can go to look. I think many people have used the site at Johns Hopkins from the very beginning to see. And here's a snapshot from this morning showing you the tally, a terrible tally of number of cases in the US, 25 million cases. You can see other countries that have had very heavy burden from this. And over on the other side, the number of deaths in the world now, 2.2 million people have lost their lives to SARS-CoV-2. Roughly one quarter of those in the United States, even though we have only 5% of the population, and that tells you something about whether we've managed this very well or not. The map right now shows you active cases as of this morning, and you can see particularly the Americas and Europe being very hard hit, but no part of the world has been spared from this terrible infection. Every morning when I meet with my staff to talk about the status of COVID-19, we often look at this particular website that shows you day by day what's happening with the number of cases, the number of tests, the number of hospitalizations, and sadly, the number of deaths. And this particular chart shows you going back to April 1st. So you can see in one swoop here what's happened. Just look at this particular demonstration of cases. Back that first bump there, that was when we had a terrible outbreak, particularly in New York City. And we thought that was the worst it could be. And then in the summertime, spreading across the Southeast and over into the West, another even worse number of cases. And now we're in this terrible surge, the third bump here, which goes higher than any of the others. The number of cases, of course, depends a lot on how much testing you're doing, because if you don't test, you won't know somebody has a case. But the number of hospitalizations is a much more sturdy rendition. So when you look at that graph, you will see the first and the second wave, similarly in terms of numbers of people hospitalized, terrible, up to 60,000. But the third wave, going over 130,000. Now you can see that that peak seems to have dropped off. And just the last 10 or 14 days, with some encouragement then that maybe this third wave is beginning to ease off a bit. It hasn't eased off much though in terms of the most dreadful of all of these graphs, which is deaths. We are still seeing many days with over 3,000 deaths in one day. And that translates into about 2 deaths per minute. And again, a very, very devastating outcome. These curves, if you watch them closely, follow the kind of course that is now all too painfully familiar, that when you see an outbreak, first what you see is cases going up, and then a couple of weeks later, hospitalizations going up, and then another 2 weeks later, deaths going up, just progressing in this in unforgiving, awful way that this virus is capable of doing. So we are still in a very deeply concerning circumstance. And I'm just showing you the data in the US, and every country has data of this sort, and it's all readily available on the web. So wherever you are, it would be well, a good thing, I think, for scientists to be fully informed at every moment about the status of what's happening in their countries. Particularly of grievous aspect of this in the United States is the way in which this particular pandemic has hit groups very hard who were already those suffering from health disparities, African Americans, Hispanics, American Indians. You can see from the graph here, the rate of hospitalizations for those groups is substantially higher, in some instances, threefold higher than it is for the majority white group. And certainly the same turns out to be true, not just for hospitalizations, but for deaths. And you can see from the diagram, there are multiple reasons that that might be the case. But we should not be able to look at this without feeling a sense of deep distress. And if you wanted an opportunity for a bright light to be shown on the health disparities and the racial inequities in our country, here is that bright light. And we must not miss the chance to learn from this and to do something about the fact that our healthcare system continues to be inequitable. As the director of NIH, it's been my job to try to identify the things that we could do as the largest supporter of biomedical research in the world to address this. And it is sort of a three-legged stool of diagnostics, developing a lot of new technologies, therapeutics, treatments for people who are already infected, and of course, vaccines. Because of time, I'm not going to go into these in great detail. In fact, I will say almost nothing about diagnostics. I'll tell you a little bit about therapeutics and mostly focus on vaccines. With therapeutics, it became clear to me back last spring that we had a scattershot going on where a lot of people thought various interventions might work. We're trying them in small trials that were probably insufficiently powered to give you a rigorous answer, and we weren't going to get anywhere that way. So we pulled together, and I've spent a lot of my personal time on this in the last 9 months, basically 20 industry partners, multiple government agencies, a lot of academics and nonprofits, and said, let's all get around the same table. Let's identify what are the most likely therapeutics that might save lives and get them quickly into rigorous randomized controlled trials so we'll know if they work or not. Let's design master protocols so that those can be quickly tested. And let's pull together all the clinical trial networks that might be able to conduct such trials quickly so that we don't waste time trying to find the right network for the right trial. Out of that, we have come up with a variety of conclusions, and many are still in the works. For therapeutics, for early course of disease, we do know that remdesivir, which is an antiviral, provides benefit. It's not a home run, but it clearly reduces the severity of the illness in people who are sick. Monoclonal antibodies derived from people who have survived COVID-19 and which can therefore be turned into pharmaceutical products and offered to people who are infected and not yet able to fight it off with their own immune system, that has been granted emergency use authorization in the United States by the FDA. Two different companies, Lilly and Regeneron, are producing these. Other antivirals in clinical trials, convalescent plasma, basically taking plasma from people who've survived and offering it to those who are sick, doesn't look as if it provides a great deal of benefit later in the disease, but maybe very early, before your own immune system has kicked in, this can help you. And therapies for moderate or advanced disease, a combination of two different drugs, baricitinib and remdesivir, also has reached the point of emergency use authorization. We're doing clinical trials of immunomodulators because people who are very sick with COVID-19 seem in many instances to have already eliminated the virus, but the immune system is in overdrive and is doing more harm than good in what's called a cytokine storm. And so trials seem to be, in fact, already showing some promising results to calm that down and give people a better chance to survive. And dexamethasone, which is a very powerful steroid, also fits into that zone and is now standard of care. And we know that this is a disease that results in an enhancement of blood clotting. And so anticoagulants are being tested. And we have recent data suggesting that full dose heparin, which is an anticoagulant, can in fact greatly improve the outcome of people who have been hospitalized, but who are not yet really sick. So much going on in this space, bit by bit making progress, but we don't have at the present time what you would call a perfect therapeutic. What we'd like to have is an oral agent that could be given as soon as somebody tests positive and that basically wipes the virus out. And that is a very difficult challenge to achieve and has not yet been reached. But let's talk about vaccines, because that's obviously where we all hope we will be able to get through this and put this terrible pandemic in the rearview mirror. There are three different platforms that are being supported through Operation Warp Speed, this big effort in the United States to try to accelerate progress in vaccines and manufacturing of those vaccines. Two of them utilize mRNA. I'll explain that one a little bit more. Two of them use an adenovirus as basically a delivery system to get the appropriate antigen into the body. And then two of them use basically just purified protein, that same spike protein I showed you. You can purify that in a careful procedure and inject it directly. And the immune system sees that and goes, oh, that's not me, and makes antibodies to it. And then if later on you encounter the actual SARS-CoV-2 virus, the immune system is primed and ready to go after it. Let me say a little bit more about the mRNA approach, because this is novel. This has never been done until this year to the point of getting an actual approval. And this has been one of the reasons that we've been able to go so quickly, because of the way in which this strategy allows you to put together in just a few days the design of the vaccine. Basically, you prepare synthetically the messenger RNA that codes for the spike protein of the coronavirus using what we know about the genetic code. And you know what amino acids you want to code for, so you know what messenger RNA sequence to create. You tinker with it a little bit so that it's not going to result in an inflammatory reaction. Inject that into muscle cells. The muscle cells go, oh, wait a minute, that's RNA. I know what to do with that. Translates that into the protein. The protein is then seen by the immune system, and off you go with the generation of protective, even neutralizing antibodies against that virus. This has been basically the flagship of all of the vaccine efforts, in part because it could be started so quickly, within days, in the NIH Vaccine Research Center. And now here we are with two different mRNA-based vaccines that were cleared by FDA for emergency use back in December, a little over a month ago, and with astoundingly high efficacies, 94, 95%. When we were designing these, and this has been a labor of many people, but certainly Tony Fauci and I have been in the middle of this from the beginning. We would sort of say, well, what would you consider to be a good outcome? And I think most of us thought, you know, if you got 60% efficacy, that would still be pretty amazing. And to come up with 94 to 95, that was a moment not to be missed in terms of a sense of thankfulness that this strategy had actually worked this well and with very effective and very good records as far as safety. Just have to point this out about how dramatically advanced the timetable was here, showing you here what's happened with other vaccines for infectious diseases. And you will notice COVID-19 down here, 11 months. The closest one we have to that was measles. That was 10 years. Now, admittedly, that was decades ago. We've learned a lot in the process, but 11 months is an astounding record. And let me assure you, that was not done by cutting corners as far as safety or rigor. Everything in that space was probably done at a higher level of scientific rigor than in any previous vaccine. Every one of these trials involved 30,000 participants at phase three. So one should not be worried that somehow the fact that this was done quickly and it was called warp speed, which maybe was not the best name because that made people nervous, be reassured. All this data is publicly accessible. You can go and look at it right now. And I think you'll be impressed and astounded by the breadth and depth of the data that backs up these decisions about emergency use authorization. Now, just in the last 3 days, there have been new developments with other vaccines. Novavax, which is this one based upon purified protein, announced, not in the US yet, they're in the middle of their US trial, but in England, they got 90% efficacy, but they also ran a small trial in South Africa. And there, that dropped to under 50%. What's that about? I'll explain that in a moment, but that is a worrisome finding. And then just yesterday, I led a press conference revealing the results of the Johnson & Johnson, also called Janssen, because it's a subdivision of Johnson & Johnson. This one is based on adenovirus, that other platform that I mentioned, showing 85% efficacy against severe disease, but only in the 60s or 70s efficacy against any kind of disease, which is somewhat lower than what we saw with the messenger RNA. But of course, what people really want to know is this going to keep me from being in the hospital or dying? And in this case, this looked pretty good. But this one also had an arm in South Africa. And the effect in South Africa was a reduced responsiveness, only about 57% effectiveness against moderate disease. Fortunately, still 85% against severe disease, even in South Africa. So why is that happening? Well, this is a source of considerable concern that, in fact, this virus, even though it's an RNA virus that doesn't have a history of making a lot of rapid changes, has been acquiring mutations, in part because there is just such a huge population of this virus around that even a low mutation rate has the chance of generating new variants. And this is evolution in action. A new variant that is actually a little better at being transmissible is going to take over the population. And we have seen that now. The original Wuhan strain is no longer around. There is a change in it, a single amino acid, that's what these abbreviations mean, that made it slightly better at transmissibility. And so the old strain's gone because it was outcompeted by the new one. You may have read in the UK, this strain with the awkward name B117, not just one mutation, but 17 of them, has now been proven to be 50 to 70% more transmissible and maybe more dangerous. And that has pretty much taken over all of the virus populations in the southern part of the UK. A particularly concerned issue now is the South African variant called B1351, which has this E484K. So what does that mean? That's another amino acid change, and it's right in that binding domain of the spike protein that I showed you. And that means that it could potentially evade the immune response that comes from vaccinating against the original virus. And in fact, we do believe that's why both Novavax and Janssen vaccines have reduced efficacy in South African patients, because they're carrying this new mutant. And cases of that mutation have now appeared in the US just 2 days ago. And then there's a Brazilian variant, which also has this same E484K, but has arisen independently, what you might call convergent evolution. and has devastated a Brazilian city and has now been identified in Minnesota. And then there's California, which has its own variant, which might be one of the reasons they're having such a terrible time in Los Angeles. This is going to keep happening. What is the best way for us to deal with this? Well, let's get everybody to really double down on public health measures so that we don't keep spreading this virus around and giving it more and more chances to do this. And let's get everybody vaccinated as quickly as possible with the existing vaccines, because that is also the way to get to herd immunity and provide an opportunity to send this virus packing. But these evolving mutations are certainly a source of considerable concern. We could redesign the vaccines to cover these, but it won't happen overnight. And then there's this issue. Okay, so we have vaccines now. We have doses, close to 50 million doses have been distributed. But we also understand that not everybody's excited about this. Something like half of Americans say, yeah, I'm up for this. And then there's a bunch of people who are just not sure, and some who are frankly really quite opposed. And that's particularly true of groups that traditionally have not been well served by our healthcare system or who have been victims of research such as the Tuskegee study done on African Americans, where information was handled in a truly unethical way. And so we have a lot of work to do there. We have been working very hard with many collaborators to try to put together the kind of community outreach that it will be necessary to have in place to acquire the trust of communities that, based on past experience, don't necessarily embrace the idea of government-sponsored or industry-sponsored offers of vaccines because they feel like they've been to that movie and it didn't turn out well. So we have a lot of work to do to try to gain trust and share the actual information that now is attached to all of these advances. If you want to know more about what's happening in COVID, I'll just do a quick advertisement here for my blog, which I put out twice a week. And most of what I've done in the last year has been about COVID. So it's very easy to find that. These are intended to be accessible to both scientists and non-scientists. Well, let me finish, though, with this question. What should scientists who are Christians be doing at the time of COVID? Well, we are fortunate. As scientists, we're able to look at evidence. We're able to sift through publications. We're able to look at claims of various sorts, including some that may, in fact, be based upon misunderstanding. And we can convey the facts, the evidence, the truth, but not by beating people over the head, but always in love. That's one of the gifts that we've been given as scientists. And we should be using that at this time where there is so much distrust and so much misinformation. We can ourselves model the public health interventions that we know can reduce further spread. Wearing masks, maybe now we think two is better than one. Maintaining that physical distancing of 6 feet, avoiding indoor gatherings, and getting vaccinated as soon as the priorities allow you to sign up and be very public about it. Hey, I'm a scientist. I looked at the data. I think this is safe. I think you should take advantage of it too. BioLogos also has put out this statement, which has now been signed by more than 6,500 scientists, about how you really could take actions to try to love your neighbor and wear a mask. Have a look at that. Sign up if you haven't already. And yes, here's me getting my Moderna vaccine, trying to make it very public, putting this into national television to make it clear that the director of the NIH believes that this particular vaccine is safe and effective. And when given the chance, I wanted to have it too. And just 3 days ago, I had the chance to host another person getting that vaccine at NIH. This is our new vice president, Kamala Harris. And this, again, a particularly important example because of her origins from minority communities in South Asia and an African-American community. Just giving people the confidence that somebody who you think is kind of like you and looks like you is signing up for this. We need to do as much of that as possible. Spread the word about what people can do in terms of taking part in trials. We're still running vaccine trials. Novavax is running theirs right now. We have treatment trials for people who've tested positive. We need people to sign up. And we need people to donate plasma for these convalescent plasma trials. And of course, if you're a doctor, you want to know what all those options are. This site, Combat COVID, is aiming to put all of that into one place with very accessible information for anybody. Spread that around. And then, of course, in addition to modeling public health behavior, you can be a source of expert advice for your church and your community about the value of these public health measures The reasons to continue worship virtually, not in person, because that has been, in many instances, an occasion of super spreading, and people have died as a result of the determination to keep worship services going in person and not paying attention to the risks. We need to focus on other actions that we as believers and church members can do to help those who are grieving or in economic distress. The food bank, asking your neighbors, can I go to the grocery store for you if you're at high risk? And of course, providing a listening ear to people who are really suffering through all of this. And be prepared with evidence about safety and efficacy of vaccines when those conspiracies are floating around. And there's so many of them that are outrageous many times in their content, but which seem to have gotten the attention of people who may not have the scientific background to appreciate just why those really shouldn't be taken seriously. And then take part also in discussions about the spiritual significance of the pandemic. People ask, how would a loving God allow this to happen? There are not easy answers to that. Let none of us say, oh, I've got the answer to that. But there are some things that you might want to look at. Here are two books that have just come out in the last few months by two very serious thinkers about this, the theologian Tom Wright, God and the Pandemic, and the scientist, a believer who's written wonderfully about science and faith, John Lennox, Where is God in a Coronavirus World? And of course, we are all struggling with this ourselves, aren't we? What is it that we should think about the appearance of this kind of viral outbreak? And where is God in this circumstance? And as scientists, we know, well, this is the consequence of what you'd call a zoonosis, a virus that probably came from a bat, and perhaps because humans have gotten a little too close to the rest of the animal kingdom, has now jumped across into our species, and why should we be blaming God for that? But it's also an opportunity for us to examine ourselves and say, what lessons could we learn here? And of course, let us not say that we are in a position, despite all the smart science that I've talked about, to know all the answers. And I guess as I read through the scriptures, and I've done a lot of that this year, particularly focused on the Psalms, I keep coming back to Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. We got trouble, don't we? Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. God is our refuge and strength. And for that, I am deeply grateful. Thank you all very much for listening, and I'd be happy now to hear your question.
Thank you, Francis. My mind is now full. It's, and I'm sure we all are, as I'm, the questions have been coming in steadily. And I want to read to start with, because this is about lessons that we can learn and take away. And you just did that so well in summing that up. So I want to just summarize, because several questions came in and they said, what can I do? How can I help? And that's characteristic, as you know, of men and women of faith and members of Biologos ASA, that desire to do something. You gave us some clear indications to be well-informed as scientists, to get on those websites, because we are a source of information to those around us and in our day-to-day activity. Mm-hmm. And then I thought, secondly, you said something really important when you said, do not miss the chance to see and address this racially defined disparities that COVID is shining this bright light upon. And it's created an opportunity. Those of us who lived through the 1960s and the time of troubles then in civil discourse, and we're seeing a similar time again. And so here we have another opportunity to speak into that. And COVID has done that for us. And then just to care for those who are grieving. And you mentioned food banks. This is the Matthew 25 situation, right? And yes. God just wants us to do what's in front of us. What's in your hand? What do we have to do? And the opportunity. So thank you for being so clear with us about those things that we can do in a time when hope is not just in our brilliance and these marvelous vaccines, but it's also in the very practical day-to-day living. You know, as we rise up, as we sit down, as we walk along the way, we can serve and teach and be part of. Well, there's a cluster of questions, Francis, that people are asking about the vaccines. And there are several of them. I want to put in, I'm just going to cluster these and let you speak to it, because there's questions about how safe is this for pregnant women? Does, you know, the baby transmission across the placental barrier? People were asking things about the persistence. Once you're vaccinated, can you transmit after? So there's that whole suite of questions there that have come in. You want to address that?
Sure, I'll do my best. So for pregnant women, we are about to engage in an actual trial to see safety. There's no reason at the present time to think there are safety risks here. Certainly in the animal studies, there's been no evidence that this virus is able to cross the placenta. And certainly there were people in the large-scale trials who didn't realize they were pregnant, but turned out to be. And as far as we can tell, there has been no consequence. So we would love to have more rigorous data, and that will be coming forward. At the present time, you should talk to your OBGYN if you're pregnant and have the opportunity for vaccination. Keep in mind that people who are sick with COVID near the time of delivery, that can be an increased risk to the mother as well as the baby. So there might be a reason to consider getting vaccinated even during pregnancy, given that we think it's safe. But talk to your OBGYN about that. In terms of what we know about whether the vaccine will actually prevent people from being infectious, we don't know that yet. We rather think it should greatly reduce that, but because we don't have the data just yet and hope to in another few weeks, people should still be wearing masks even after vaccination, you know, just in case that they could still be carrying the virus and could infect others. In terms of the duration of protection that we get from the vaccine, we don't really know. We don't really know what the duration of protection from natural infection from COVID-19 is. There have been very few examples of people who seem to have gotten infected a second time with a different virus. I mean, very few. So we think that the duration is probably many months. We hope many years. We hope a lifetime, but we do not know. And it's certainly likely, if you had to ask most experts, that some kind of a booster may be necessary for people in order to maintain that immunity going forward.
Mm-hmm. And how about children? People ask the efficacy and safety for children.
Good question there as well. We are doing trials now down to children age 12. So far, so good. And once those appear to have done what we need to as far as data, we'll then go down to age 6. It's the way you always do this when you have a new drug or a new vaccine. You first want to check it out in people at lower risk, adults and people who are not pregnant. And then you work towards those higher risk groups. Again, at the present time, looks very promising, but we don't have the data. We need that, of course, if we're going to actually plan to immunize all Americans and get everybody back to school.
Mm-hmm. You know, the challenge of a natural experiment like a pandemic is the speed at which things happen. The rapidity of our work, and we're rolling things out. As you emphasize the safety and the testing, what we do, but people recognize this is all compressed. Right? I mean, from 2 years to 10 months, and it leaves us spinning. Is there some cautionary tales there for us that are arising from that rapidity?
Yeah, and it is breathtaking. And I just mentioned these new mutations that are arising, and those are happening at breathtaking speed, and the need to adapt and address those right away is something we've never really had to quite do in this kind of timetable. We must learn from this not to go back into complacency once we've gotten past SARS-CoV-2, because this will not be the last pandemic our world has to face. And it would be truly bad planning if we decided to just shut down all the preparations after we get through this one and then get hit again unexpectedly with something and not be ready to go. I think we've learned a huge amount in the last year. I will say, I think science has proven itself amazingly successful in attacking all of these challenges. But we've learned some things along the way for the next time that we must not forget.
So this ties to another part of our members. You move from the science to the application, the engineering of distribution systems, right? And the equity questions that come to mind to social scientists that you've touched on, right? But here is the question that's foremost now. Both Pfizer and Moderna have are retooling, so there's a slowing of distribution. And now we're seeing this question between nations arising. We have some 40 countries represented here. And so there's questions that are coming up. Are we really getting accuracy of reporting for instance, of cases in other countries in the two-thirds of the world that is not as well connected, perhaps. That's one piece. The other is in distribution. Are we on the cusp of a kind of international contest here? Maybe this works, this comes under your purview, maybe not.
I'm certainly part of those discussions, although NIH is much more in this ability to design and develop the vaccines. Now the distribution becomes a matter for CDC and a variety of other organizational structures in the US and of course the whole world. And yeah, there is this issue. If we Americans are only interested in immunizing ourselves, that is both a moral failing, and it's frankly a practical failing, because if this virus is still out there in many other parts of the world, we're not going to see the end of it. Look at that South African variant, and that's not the last one. So we are, even selfishly, I hate to say that, we need to be invested in getting everybody immunized. I'm glad to say the United States has rejoined the WHO. That will help, because we were at some point kind of screened out of some of those discussions, at least officially, although we kept up those communications, scientist to scientist. There is something called COVAX, which is the effort to try to figure out how to equitably distribute vaccines to the whole world. I was really glad to see the results yesterday of this Johnson & Johnson vaccine. That is one which is a single dose, doesn't take two doses. It has a very forgiving cold chain, just a refrigerator will do. And they can ramp up to make 1 billion doses this year. And to have that unleashed, that is a particularly appealing opportunity for low and middle income countries that may not have resources for 94 degrees Fahrenheit freezers, which is what the Pfizer vaccine requires. But we have to all be invested in that. And we as Christians especially ought to be out front on this argument, that this has got to be about all the peoples of the world. They're all God's children, not just the ones that happen to live in the United States of America.
Yeah, thank you for that. That's a real reminder that we're all involved. All of the skills and giftings come to the table on this. The engineering of these distribution systems, it just kind of boggles our mind. I mean, all the things that happen behind COVID once again has shown us that the most important people are those who change the beds, who provide the food, those who sweep the halls, those who care for us that are not in the picture on a day-to-day basis.
But they're heroes, yes.
And then, you know, I'm thinking of the engineers and the administrators and all. It's quite remarkable how this has opened up a real human story for us.
Yes.
So now I want to turn back to another, this is a more technical thing, but from your medical perspective, there's a phenomenon called long haulers that has shown up. And we don't hear much about it, but these folks that you did mention it in the autoimmune system. Yeah. And so what can you say about long haulers?
Very serious issue, and we don't know nearly enough about it. But it's clear that when you follow people who have had COVID-19, they don't all get better in the space of a couple of weeks the way you'd expect for a respiratory virus. People have these lingering symptoms, maybe as many as a third of the people who got sick. And that's not just the people who ended up in the ICU on a ventilator. Those are people who maybe had fairly mild illness and didn't go to the hospital at all, but they can't seem to shake it. They have brain fog, this sort of fuzziness in their thinking, which is something's happened there in terms of brain function. They may have cardiac abnormalities, fatigue. They may have other features of other organ systems, persistent shortness of breath. We don't understand that. We don't really understand which people are susceptible to that long effect, the so-called long haulers. Mm-hmm. NIH is mounting in the next couple of weeks a major billion-dollar effort to try to track maybe 10,000 people who are recovering from COVID-19 to understand how frequent is this, what are the features if you really look hard, and what are the ways to prevent it, and then to treat the people who are in that circumstance, some of whom many months afterwards are still not able to go back to work. We need to understand that. This could be a very long tail of misery on top of the acute problem of COVID.
And with that, I want to ask you, what gives you hope in this? Because there's much that we do not understand. And you've touched on it, and I think we should bring our Q&A session to a close by touching once again on what I think are the two H's, humility and hope, that inform us as people of faith.
Yes.
What's the hope?
Well, my hope primarily rests in Jesus, and that is the best hope any of us can have. I think we have been given a gift as scientists to be able to bring those tools to this, and that gives me hope. I wear this little pin on my lapel, which says hope at NIH. We think of the National Institutes of Health as also the National Institutes of Hope, because we try to bring those scientific insights and discoveries to help people who are waiting for answers to medical problems. And this is certainly a great example of that. But again, hope really, if it's going to be serious, it needs to be attached not just to sort of vague ideas, but to action. And I think we as Christians are called to take that hope and bring it forward to try to help out in every way that we can. And I listed some of them. And for those that are involved in the scientific effort, it's a little bit easier to say what your actions are that are going to give you that chance to practice hope. But we can all do that in many other ways. And I think, you know, over the centuries, Christians, when faced with a plague, have been the ones who ran toward it. The Antonine Plague in 186 AD. It was the Christians who tried to help those who were sick, who stayed in Rome when everybody else was running to the countryside and tried to care for those who were sick and dying. That was one of the reasons people began to take Christianity seriously. Like, these people are different. Mm-hmm. But we should be doing that again. We should be the light on the hill. We should be the people talking about the facts and the evidence and doing so with love and reaching out to those who are suffering. We can all do that. And that gives me hope to contemplate the ways in which we can spread the good news and our own actions in that fashion. And we will get through this, but we've got quite a number of dark months yet to go.
And we all said amen in the congregation. Oh, thank you, Francis. I'm going to turn back to Vicki and have her bring a few words if she would come in now.
Well, there might be a little surprise coming here, too, so I don't know how you want to do that part.
Yeah, I think there is a surprise. And actually, maybe we should just spring that surprise right now.
Well, we can do that.
Oh, look at this. What instrument is that? That's a medical instrument of hope, I'm sure.
Well, we can decide later whether it was hope or the opposite thereof. But yeah, this is Rosalind, my guitar that has the double helix on the fretboard, which is a wonderful gift to me by people that worked with me on the Human Genome Project. And I just thought, you know, we're having a gathering here, but maybe it's also a little bit of a worship service, so maybe there ought to be a closing hymn. And of course, I would love it if we could sing all together, but by Zoom, that does not work. So if you'll forgive me, I'm just going to sing you something myself. And this is very fresh. This is a world premiere. I did see on the web, looking at the last few days, a wonderful poem. And it seemed to be calling out for a tune. And so I've written the tune, which is not nearly as good as the poem. But this is a powerful poem about what we've just been talking about COVID and what we need to think about in terms of who's really in charge, which is our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Christ still rises when fear grips our city, when death has no pity, when much is unknown. Christ still rises when friends are divided, when joy feels misguided, when we are alone. Christ still rises when churches are shuttered, when worship is muttered, when prayers go unsaid. Christ still rises when peace has all faded, when we are most jaded, when all hope seems dead, when tears have been shed. Christ still rises when we give to our neighbors, when we share all our labors, when strangers belong. Christ still rises when we come together, when love is our tether, when hope is our song. Christ still rises when grieving is ended, when bodies are mended, when beauty heals the pain. Christ still rises when fear has retreated, when death is defeated, and love will remain, and joy will be made. And love will remain, and joy will remain, and joy will remain.
May joy remain. Amen.
Thank you so much, Francis. You're such a calming voice of faith and reason, and what impactful lessons for all of us. You're a gifted leader, and you wrestle with difficult issues with so much gravitas, grace, extraordinary expertise, and such humility. And God is certainly using you in amazing ways. And what a powerful song. We last heard Francis speak and perform in person at our 2018 annual conference at Gordon, where he gave a lecture to a packed audience and concluded with one of his signature songs. And then at a reception afterwards, we were blessed to have him entertain us on guitar and vocals with classic songs from Bob Dylan to Amazing Grace, with the whole crowd singing together late into the night. It was such a special time for everyone, and one that I will fondly remember for a long time.
As will I.
Yeah. As I mentioned earlier, Francis is a great ambassador of the American Scientific Affiliation, and many of our members tell us they learned of the ASA through his book, The Language of God. In fact, one of our Sharp postdoc members, Matt Solt at the University of Virginia, tells us that he joined the ASA after reading your book, Francis, and he was deeply honored to meet you at the Gordon Conference and to have the ability to thank you for your excellent work. So I'm delighted to announce that for the month of February, we have partnered with Christian Book to offer you a complimentary copy of Francis's book. If you join as a paying member of the ASA, you can find all the details of membership at asa3.org and in the chat box. We'd love to welcome you to our community with this gift. As we close our time today, I invite all of you joining to join us in a word of prayer. O most holy and righteous God, you are the ruler of the cosmos, giver of every good and perfect gift, our Father of all compassion, who gave his only Son so that we might have eternal life. You have been our dwelling place, Lord, through all generations, and we are deeply grateful to you this day and every day. As we place our faith in you and you alone, we are trusting that you are using these challenging days for your transformative purposes. Father God, you are all-powerful, you are all-loving, and you hear our prayers. So this day, for your many servants around the world in the midst of this global pandemic, we pray for healing of the sick, as you are the great physician, for comfort and peace for those mourning the loss of loved ones, for strength and endurance for healthcare workers and the many working on the front lines of the crisis, for the oppressed and those without equal access to health care. Give us hearts of care and compassion for the most vulnerable, and for wisdom and discernment for our leaders around the globe, both nationally and in local communities, such as professors and teachers, scientists working on the vaccine, government officials, pastors, leaders of faith-based organizations, and the like. Please continue to bless Francis and his work in leading the nation's biomedical research. We ask you to lift him up, give him effectiveness and wisdom in his service, and continue to draw people to yourself using him as your vessel. You are our refuge and strength, ever-present help in trouble, and our hope and faith are found in you and you alone. And while we celebrate the gift of scientific insight and wisdom equip us to be the church around the world, showing tangible expressions of love for our neighbors. Lord, we long for the day when all tears will be wiped away and we meet you face to face. Until then, we humbly ask you to hear our prayers. Go with us now in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Francis, again, thank you so very much. We are very grateful to have you here today. And thank you to everybody joining us. We wish you many blessings and we'll see you on the next link. Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you. Blessings to you all.
Thanks, Francis.